Well, y'all, I'm really excited right now because I'm fixing to go on a bit of a little bit of a road trip. I'm going to be spending 2 nights just north of here in Kentucky. As you can tell, it's raining right now. That's because of the tropical storm that's coming through here right now. Laura, I think, is what it is. One thing I want to try and prove in this video is that rain does not ruin herping. You can still find snakes even when or after it's rained. It's definitely possible. Let's just go ahead and get on the road, and I'm excited. I always love me a good trip, so let's do it.
Picture perfect, you don't need no filter. Gorgeous, make them drop dead, you a killer. Shower you with all my attention. Yeah, these are my only intentions. Stay in the kitchen cooking up, cut your own bread. Heart full of equity, you're an asset. Make sure that you don't need no mentions. Yeah, these are my only intentions. Shout out to your mom and dad for making you.
And we are here, baby. We are here. Oh, here we are. It's my campground. I'm actually not going to set up my stuff right now because there are some flip sites that I want to go to right now because, you know, I'm excited. I want to find snakes. But yeah, I had to check into my campsite first, so here we are. This is going to be a great weekend. I'm excited. Let's go flip some snakes. About a ringneck snake. So, like I said, you know, I'd probably be finding a lot more of the common stuff too. I haven't found anything rare yet, but I just flipped this little ringneck snake. It's actually not a bad sized one. You can see he's about 8 inches, which is an average adult size. So this is a nice little find. You know, ringneck snakes are really, really common. Like I said, you know, you flip them underneath boards and tin and rocks and stuff like that pretty commonly. And, you know, they're the largest of the small terrestrial species that we get around here. I mean, you may look at this and think it's a baby snake, but it's actually not. This is an adult snake. There's actually a select few species of snakes that only get to about this big, and this is one of those species. And out of all of them, these guys, the ringneck snakes, get the largest. So, beautiful little snake. And they actually are mildly venomous, believe it or not. But, you know, they pretty much never bite people. So, you know, it's nothing that could affect a human very badly. So, I'm gonna go ahead and put him back and see if I can find anything else. Cool snake. All right, let's put this little guy back. And keep looking. Lots of stuff to flip in here. Alright, here's the cover I was looking for. Here she is. Jesus. How about this? Snakes. Not snakes. Alright. We have snakes. Look at this. Looky here. So, we have two snakes, and they are both rat snakes. Check these guys out. These are both gray rat snakes. Now, rat snakes are the longest species of snake that you're going to be finding out here. These are both relatively small individuals. Well, I wouldn't call them small. This one's a bit on the small side, but this one's more on about the medium side. Now, you may be asking, why is he so thick right here? Well, take a guess. It's because he just ate a meal. Now, and for that reason, I don't want to handle this snake for too crazy long, because, you know, what happens if you handle a snake for too long after it's eaten and that meal is fresh, what might happen is they actually might throw it up. And the reason for that is because it makes them lighter, it makes it easier for them to escape, it might gross a predator out. You know, it's just basically something for them to do to help them not get eaten, right? That's why if you see a snake with food in it, it's either best to just not mess with it at all or handle it for a very short period of time. So that's exactly what I'm gonna do with this guy. What he's probably got in there, he's probably got a rat, a rodent of some kind, which he killed by constriction, right? These aren't venomous. and they're not like racers that, you know, pile drive their, you know, food into the ground and then just swallow it alive. These guys don't do that. They constrict, and that means that they wrap around their prey, they squeeze really, really hard, and from there, they asphyxiate them, and then they can swallow their prey easier because then it's dead. Really, really beneficial snakes. If you ever see any of these snakes, rat snake, corn snake, anything related to them, it's always a great idea to not kill them, all right? I never recommend you kill any snake, but especially not rat snakes, because they are really, really great for helping control the rodent population. You know, we need a lot of animals to help control the rodent population, and rat snakes do a fantastic job of it. Think of it. You know, hawks and owls may be able to eat rodents, but, you know, the hawks and owls, they can't go down into the holes where the rodents go, right? And that's the first place a rodent's gonna go if they feel threatened, but these guys can. So they're like our ground defense against rodents overpopulating. So they're really, really important. So yeah, these are one of North America's most iconic and important snakes, the gray rat snake. Very nice. I'm gonna let both of these guys go and see if I can find anything else. All right, time to let both of these guys go. So I'm just gonna kinda let them find their way right down into here. Beautiful snakes. There y'all go, back home. That's it. You see he's shaking his tail there. And that's a defensive mechanism, you know, it hits against dry stuff and it makes a raspy kind of noise. It's an audible warning so that predators can, you know, hopefully stay away from them. Awesome stuff. Well, I was just walking along and I see a snake right here. I think it's another ringneck snake. Look at that. He was literally just crawling up inside these spokes of wood right here. Yeah, it's another ringneck snake. Now that's actually pretty interesting because that's not something that you have happen very often where you find these just out in the open like that. Usually you have to flip them underneath something, so pretty neat. And see this one, he's got quite a bit more patterning on his belly. He's got more spots on it. Beautiful snake. Looks like he's having a bit of a bad shed there. All right, well I'm going to let him go. Very interesting. You don't usually see them out in the open like that. All right, well, it's starting to rain. And, you know, I just spent a while shining my light up in the rafters up here because that can be good for finding a lot of different stuff. Rat snakes and corn snakes especially, which I'm hoping to see some this trip. But it's starting to rain, so I'm going to go ahead and head on out. Not because rain is bad for snakes, but just because I don't want to get soaked. Oh, yeah. It's starting to come down. Let's get out of here. Okay, well that just happened. Yeah, the bottom kind of just fell out there. I'm gonna see if maybe this rain will, you know, kind of dissipate in a little bit, because I mean, I don't really want to go herping in the middle of the rain right now because I don't want to get soaking wet. But once the rain stops, that actually might prove very, very effective as compared to if there was no rain at all. And you're gonna see why in just a minute here. Let's see what happens. So I was off to the next spot, excited to go flip some more tin. Everybody knows that tin flipping is great, and that you're bound to find a pretty good amount of snakes, whenever you do it. But what I was about to experience was unlike any tin flipping experience I have ever had in my entire life. Just watch. Oh, there's a shed skin of something. It might be under this. Oh, look, copperhead. Copperhead right there. Y'all see it? Check it out. Beautiful copperhead. Now this one's a little bit darker than the ones I'm used to seeing. I'm gonna go ahead and show y'all a closer look at this snake real quick. So now I'm not really gonna, you know, try and handle him or anything like that because I don't really feel like messing with him. I'm just gonna leave him right where he is, but y'all take a look at that beautiful little, what I'm believing to be a northern copperhead. I mean, obviously, you know, the subspecies for copperheads kind of got revoked, but nonetheless, a gorgeous little snake. This is a venomous pit viper. Now, this is probably the least venomous snake that you're gonna be finding out here. You know, they're not hardly ever lethally toxic, but obviously you wanna leave them alone if you ever see one. And look, they're not gonna, you know, chase after you or bite you for no good reason. You know, I mean, you can see I'm sitting right next to this thing and it's made no attempt to, you know, bite me or attack me or anything like that. And he's just kinda wandering about and doing his little copperhead things. So I'm gonna go ahead and put this back and let him, hey, you can go back in your little hole, buddy. Yeah, there you go. All right, well, I'm gonna go ahead and set that back down for him very gently and see what else I can find. Nice little snake. Oh my God. Oh my God, it's a corn snake. It's a freaking corn snake, yes. This is one of the snakes I was really hoping to find. on this trip. Oh my goodness. Beautiful. Wow, look at this. Look at this. Y'all just take a look at this. What a snake. What a gorgeous snake. Beautiful. Oh my gosh. If you can't tell, I don't get to see corn snakes very often. Wow, what a snake, man. All right, I gotta give y'all a closer look at this thing. Oh my gosh, y'all, look at this thing. So corn snakes, they're just one of my favorite snakes. I don't know if y'all remember, I was talking about how I was trying to find a corn snake up in those rafters, and this is it. This is a corn snake. Now, they are usually found in the same places as rat snakes because they're very, very closely related to them. They're in the same genus, Pantherophis, so they're very, very closely related, but they look almost completely different. Morphologically, they look identical, but coloration-wise, they are completely distinct, and, you know, the main differentiation of them is that just that beautiful orange coloration. What's interesting about this individual is that usually corn snakes, they're gonna have like a piano key checkerboard kind of belly. Now this one, it's got a little bit of it. It's pretty faint though. You know, usually it's a lot more distinct than this. Just like the rat snakes, they're extremely valuable snakes. They feed primarily on rodents, so mice, rats, things like that, that we consider vermin. And, you know, if they do get overpopulated, the rats and mice, you know, they will cause problems. Diseases, crop destruction, infestation, you know, a lot of things that we don't want. If you go around killing snakes, you're doing a massive disservice to not just the ecosystem, but to yourself and the others that live around you, because you got to think, you know, every year in the United States, hardly anybody dies from snake bites. You know, it's usually less than 10. So you're really not making the area safer for people. You're not helping people out at all. If you encounter a snake, all you have to do to not get bit is leave them alone. That is all you have to do. But more cool stuff about the corn snake, they typically like open habitat, kind of like what I'm in right now. They like fields, you know, abandoned buildings like I was in before. They love those kinds of places. What a freaking snake, the corn snake. I'm gonna go ahead and put this guy back underneath his tin and keep flipping stuff, and hopefully we'll get some of those other rare species I was talking about. Just lovely. All right, little guy. I'm just gonna set him right back under his piece of tin and see if I can find anything else. What a freaking snake. So glad I got to show you all this. Wonderful. All right, let's see if there's anything else. Oh, rat snake. Look at this. I thought it was a hognose snake at first, but it's just a rat snake, but still, very cool. Now, I'm not really gonna mess with him because, you know, we already saw a rat snake, so I'm just gonna let him sit there. But yeah, he's in his opaque cycle right now. You can see why his eye is blue. That means that he's gonna shed pretty soon. Now, you know, a lot of people may know that, but one thing that not as many people know is that he's not gonna go straight from this form to shedding his skin. He's going to go from this form to looking like he was completely back to normal, then he'll shed his skin right after that. Beautiful little snake. I wonder if anything's under this box. All right, well, I'm just gonna leave him be, not mess with him since we've already seen a rat snake. It's all about being gentle, you know? Just gently put it down and he'll be happy, so cool. Oh, what in the... No way. Look at this. Oh my god, y'all will not believe what I just found. Oh my god. That just happened. Y'all know what this is? Y'all know what the heck this is? This is a freshly hatched brood of prairie king snakes. Oh my god. That's insane. Holy crap. Y'all have got to see this. Hold on. Y'all just look at this. I've got two of them right here. And this is another one of the rare species I was hoping to show y'all on this trip. These are prairie king snakes. So you could see they were just right outside of their little hole. And the theory about rain is this. If it rains a lot, the theory goes is that, you know, the water goes down into the holes and it encourages those more fossorial species like prairie king snakes to surface out of their burrows. So rain can be an asset for herping, depending on what you're looking for. And in my case, looking for these, amazing little fossorial species like these prairie king snake juveniles. I was hoping for an adult, but I've never seen juveniles before, and I would be willing to bet that if it hadn't had rained, that may not have even happened. I may not have seen either of these snakes. This is amazing. These guys are at high risk of predation right now. Like, anything, and I mean literally anything, would eat a prairie king snake, or any snake baby for the most part. Now, these guys are lucky because of their life history, which dictates that they spend a lot of time underground, so not as many things are going to be out eating these as, you know, say, I don't know, a rat snake or something like that. They're called prairie king snakes because they typically live in grasslands, open areas, unlike, you know, the speckled king snakes and the black king snakes, which can live in open areas, but these guys are specifically oriented towards open areas like what I'm in right now. And, you know, if you hear a herper saying, Caligaster, Cali, you know, oh, it's a Cali, it's a Caligaster, that's this snake. Lampropeltis caligaster is the prairie king snake, so that's what they're talking about. So I'm gonna go ahead and get some close-up shots of these so y'all can get a better look at them, and I'm gonna let them go. Lovely. All right, well, it's time to let my beautiful little friends here go. Y'all, this is a hell of a find. I'm sure collectors would probably take these in a heartbeat, but that is not good. You should always leave what you find right back where it was. That's exactly what I'm gonna do with these guys. God, that was amazing. Oh my gosh, that was so cool. All right, let's keep looking for stuff. Wow, unbelievable. Oh, snake. There's a Decay's brown snake. Look at that. Nice. Jeez, I'm just freaking racking the species off the list. So I'm not gonna spend too crazy long with this guy because this is a snake that you see pretty commonly. This is called a Decay's brown snake, and they're in the Steraria genus. And just like the ringneck snake, this is one of those snakes that, you know, do not get very big even as an adult. Like, this snake right here is an adult, okay? You may think that's crazy, but yep, this is an adult snake, and they don't hardly get any bigger than this. Now, I have seen some that have gotten up to, you know, a little bit over a foot. That's very rare, and that would be an absolutely monstrously huge brown snake, but case in point, this is about as big as they get. The rat snakes are out eating rodents and stuff like that, but these little fellas, you know, they're out eating worms, slugs, and little invertebrates, and taking care of the micro ecosystems like that. That's where their place kind of is. And, you know, they're a bit of a bland snake, but I still love them. You know, they're a really awesome little find. And another species for today. Very nice. All right, well, I'm going to put him back and see what else is out. All right, buddy. Here you go. Right back where I found you. Yep, other way. There you go. Very nice. Cool. Little Decay's brown. Nice. Oh, ringneck. Ringneck. Look at this. Once again, like before, I got another ringneck snake. Oh my goodness, he won't sit still. Now, what he's doing right now is he's musking on me, and basically musk is a really gross mixture of like poop and pee. It comes out of their cloaca, and it's basically to make them smell like garbage so that, you know, predators don't want to eat them. And my goodness, if I were to try and eat this thing, I would, it would work. I do not want any of that stuff getting within 100 miles of my mouth, so that's a really effective defense strategy, at least if it were me. So, but yeah, another ringneck snake, very cool. So I'm just gonna put him right back and not really mess with him too much. And, oh, well, he went the other way. It's okay. He'll find his way. Oh, look at this. Well, that's not something I was expecting to see. Have I ever flipped a box turtle before? That's funny. Look at this little guy. Yeah, that's a little box turtle. What in the world? That's really funny. I wasn't expecting to see that underneath tin. You never know, though. He's so cute. Look at him. Alright, I'm not going to pester him for too much now. Since he has a very hard carapace, I'm just going to go ahead and lightly put the tin back on top of him. There's enough space under there that it won't smush him. But how about that? That is not something that happens every day, flipping a box turtle. Oh my god. Oh my god. Y'all, look at this. I just found a litter of copperheads. Oh my god. Dude. Look at this. Oh, and there's the adult. There's the adult right there. I really gotta watch where I'm treading because there could be another one that I'm just not seeing, but oh my god, this is incredible. I've never seen anything like this in my life. This is a freaking litter of copperheads. Oh my god, and you can see as they're babies, they have these bright yellow tail tips, and basically they use those tails as a, oh my goodness, as lures. They're feisty right out of the mom's womb. How about that? They'll actually sit and they'll wiggle and they'll writhe that tail around, and it looks like a worm. So, you know, if, say, a lizard or a you know, a bug or a freshly molted cicada sees that, they might go and check it out thinking they're gonna get a worm, get a meal, but then turns out they end up being the meal. So that's kind of how that works. Okay, y'all gotten a good look at that. They're starting to kind of disperse. I don't want to mess with them because, I mean, that is just, oh my God. I've never seen anything like that in my life. Oh my God, that was insane. That was utterly insane. That was a literal brood of copperheads. So basically what was going on is the mom will actually stay with the babies for a few days after they're born, and then the babies disperse and then they're on their own. Not all snakes do that. Most snakes, they're hatched or they're born from live young, as in the case of copperheads, and then they leave instantly and they're independent completely as juveniles. And they are independent as far as getting their food goes. Their mom does not get them food, but they will hang out around her for a few days after they're hatched, and then they disperse, and best of luck is to them, I guess. That was amazing. Oh my gosh. Wow, this place is incredible. Wow, all right, let's keep going. Oh, I see another ringneck snake. Look at this. So this is another ringneck, but this is definitely a larger example of one. You can see this one's pushing up to a foot, maybe. I mean, this is a larger individual snake. Oh my goodness, I'm having a hard time holding on to him. But yes, this is definitely a much larger ringneck snake, which goes back to what I was saying earlier about how these, out of all the smaller terrestrial snakes, these get the biggest, and this is a good example of that. But they can get bigger. They actually have been recorded up to 2 feet. What a snake. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and put him back. Wow, this is amazing, dude. Oh, another ringneck, look at that. Is that number 5? I mean, geez, I've seen quite a few. Oh, there he goes. All right, well, I'm gonna leave him to it. I'm not gonna bother him too much more. Geez, there's a lot of ringnecks out today. Oh, look at how tiny it is. It's another ringneck snake, but my goodness, is he a small one. Wait a minute. That's a ringneck. For a minute there, I was looking at it and briefly thought it was a red-bellied snake, but turns out it is, in fact, a little ringneck. You can see on his belly there, it's kind of a more dull color than the adults are. And these things have just been everywhere today. He is so tiny. Well, it is baby season after all. Wow. Oh my God, are you kidding me? Oh my God. What in the... How? Oh my God. This is insane. Okay, hold on. Y'all have got to look at this. Oh my God. I know, he's chomping on me. Okay, this is another one of the rare species I was wanting to show y'all. I mean, I am just ticking them off the list like it's nothing. Oh my God, this is a milk snake. I cannot believe this. I mean, this has been some of the best flipping I've ever had. Y'all, I cannot believe this is happening. And he is just feisty as heck. I got the corn snake, I got the prairie king snake, and now I have the milk snake. And there's only two other species, oh my goodness, only two other species that I'm really hoping to see this trip, and that's a hognose snake and a timber rattlesnake. If I can find those two by the end of the trip, I will have found everything I was targeting this trip. I gotta make this quick because it's starting to rain. See, you can still find stuff in the rain. So milk snakes, as a lot of you know, they're the mimic of coral snakes. I mean, this is what many, many people think. Now, if they overlap in range, that, you know, may be true. They may be actually mimicking the coral snake, but in most instances, they don't actually overlap in range. So in that case, this is just aposematic coloration, which basically means that they're bright, and bright is associated with poison, with venom, with danger of some sort. And obviously, you can tell this is not a dangerous snake. He is biting the fool out of me right now, and it's doing absolutely nothing. In fact, I hope he's not going into a feeding response, because, okay, he wasn't. I was worried there a little bit. But, you know, the milk snakes, they're related to king snakes. This is actually a king snake species, and they are just like king snakes in that they will eat other snakes, but snakes are not the only thing they will eat. They will eat other reptiles, amphibians, mammals, sometimes insects when they're younger. And, you know, he is just absolutely not having it with me, but I'm gonna go ahead and put him back real quick because, you know, he's starting to get, well, it's starting to rain a little more and he's just not happy with me, but just amazing. I can't believe it. Ah, unbelievable. All right, well, it is raining like a dog right now and my camera's about to die, so I'm just gonna let him go. I cannot believe how good this has been so far, and it's not even the end of the first day. I've still got 2 days left. Unbelievable. Look at that. You see that? See how much it's raining right now? I don't have any words. That was insane. The only point, I don't know why, because I've heard this by so many herpers so many times, is that rain is a killer of herping, but it's just not. In some instances, it can play to your advantage. In some instances, it can play to your detriment. But in most cases, if you use it correctly, you can have a good turnout. Rain doesn't ruin herping. I'm gonna get something to eat and you'll see. So, all right, let's do that. It's time to go find more snakes. Oh, snake. Oh, that's a pretty one. Beautiful snake, look at that. Oh my God. Stay in the kitchen cooking up, get your own bread.